Good afternoon, everyone. Hope I am audible to everyone. I'm welcoming
yes.
again a post-lunch session, fourth day, session two. Confidence in wearable device data will be discussed by the same speaker we have yesterday in the second. So I request Kalpesh to start your session.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible to all of you? Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So today's topic is AI used in wearable devices data. So what kind of AI or machine learning algorithms used on the various kind of data available through the various wearable devices in the market? So when you look into the different kind of wearable devices, you will come across with the various kind of the devices, right? From the smart watches to the smart ring, smart bell, smart shoes, smart socks, and so many of it. From the bigger player like the Apple, Samsung, there are some other comparatively smaller players like Xiaomi and all are also coming, OnePlus and all are coming up with their own smart bands and other smart wearables. So in the last decade or so, many wearable devices have came. The revolution started with the Fitbit, which is very well known into the smart wearable devices category, which came up in 2009. But wearable devices were very old, like since 1965, where you have a pedometers. So, and in some of the polo chest straps are existing from 1977. So wearables are not that new, but since in last decade or so, with the availability of greater sensors, the state of the art electronics and the computational power provided into the chip, so the efficiency and the the information that can be extracted to those wearable devices is enhanced a lot. So wearable devices consisting of some major parts, right, from a sensors to the electronics behind it. Through the sensors, once we extract a signal, we need to do signal processing as lots of noise is added into the signal while capturing it. Once signals is processed, we need to extract some useful information out of that signal. So we apply certain algorithms as well as machine learning techniques to do the various identification out of the signal. Maybe from the accelerometer gyroscope data, you can have exercise identification. So from ECG data, you can identify the arrhythmia present into your ECG signal. Along with that, you need some kind of domain expertise as to generate and data. For example, ECG data, you need to...
Hello. Yeah,
hello. Hello.
Uncle.
Am I audible? I think someone was saying something.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, sorry. So you need some kind of domain expertise as well, because to once your data is generated and you have to when you annotate that data, for example, you want to develop an algorithm from ECG data, which will automatically identify the arrhythmia. You need the expertise of the doctors to understand that the data, like specific ECG signal has certain kind of arrhythmia or not. So your data in data collection process, the clinical domain experts comes into the picture. So there are many benefits of the wearable devices. So right from the engaging the patient, you can have a different reports that reports can be generated automatically into the smartphone that can be shared to the doctors. You can have a real-time monitoring of your the heart rate, as well as you can have a step counts, your sleep analysis. So all those things are integrated, or as your variable is not doing one specific task, he can do multiple tasks together, comprising of a different sensors into the one variable devices. We can do multiple parameter measurement and analysis. So the significance of variable devices is like we can monitor the health continuously because it is always worn on our wrist, or maybe in other format, maybe in a shoes or maybe a chest wrap. So they can alert the health condition before one develops symptoms, because unknowingly the data is being captured from the wearable devices and logged into your smartphone, which will sync on the cloud. So automatically data has been gathered from the wearable devices, and the analysis on that data is being going on. So this will help us to engage between the patient and a doctor, and the possibility of any illness can be detected. So there are many kind of features available in the current wearable devices, right from heart rate to the oxygen saturation, blood pressure, step count, ECG recording, where you can do arrhythmia detection, exercise identification, and a sleep analysis. So to do that, you have to have some sort of a sensors present into your wearable devices. So out of it, there are three important sensors, which are the IMU sensors. The initial measurement unit comprises of accelerometer, gyroscopes, and magnetometer. And you have PPG sensor, which will give you information about the heart rate, and the ECG sensor, which will measure the electrical activity of the heart. Let's start with the IMU sensor, which is used to get the motion information. So the accelerometer has three important features. One, it is have accelerometer, then here's a gyroscope, and is a magnetometer. So not all the sensors are present in single IMU. In most of the cases, you will find gyroscope and accelerometer only. In some of the variables, you find only accelerometer. But in a broad scenario, there's a possibility of having only a single or all three into one initial measurement units. So this is a simulation of how the motion can reflect to the change into the sensor data, like how acceleration and how angular velocity and magnetic field is changing while doing a certain motion. So with the change in the motion, you get the change in the accelerometer, gyroscope, and magnetometer values, which will help you to log the motion information. Like while you're walking, there will be a different kind of pattern. While you are running, there will be a different pattern. Whenever you're doing certain exercise, you can observe a different kind of accelerometer, gyroscope, and magnetometer data. So this is basically the data from the accelerometer, mainly used for the step counting, and the data from the accelerometer in combined with the gyroscope is used for the exercise identification. So how is this algorithm works is like we acquire data. This is basically accelerometer data on a three direction from X, Y, and Z direction. So we remove any kind of a noise present into that signal. And after the noise removal, there will be the moving average is applied to smoothen out the signal so that we are just interested into the peaks, so that difference between the two peaks is as good as the step interval. So these are the steps we normally follow while extracting the step count from the accelerometer sensor. While in case of exercise identification, we have accelerometer data as well as a gyroscope data. And here you can observe that the data from the accelerometer is and data from a gyroscope for a bicep curl exercise. So when you perform a bicep curl exercise, in that case, you will observe a data from accelerometer on an AX, AY, AZ, and similarly on a, for a gyroscope, you can have a GX, GY, AZ. If you do another exercise, for example, bicep hammer, you will have a different kind of pattern. Later on in the this, we'll see one project where we'll have 8 different exercises, and we'll extract certain features out of those raw data available for the different exercises, and we'll train a machine learning model, and we'll see how model is predicting exercise properly or not. So time being, you can just have an idea like how your accelerometer and gyroscope has different information. So now what we do is we apply a certain window. So once that specific window size selected, then we move that window with certain overlap. And with the sliding window, we extract certain features. Features can be from a time domain, frequency domain, or a wavelet domain. So those extracted features are used to train your machine learning algorithm. So here, that raw data is not directly fed into the model. We do feature extraction, and those extracted features with the help, for example, let's say the sliding window, my window size is of 100 samples. So from those 100 samples, I can have a feature, simple features like mean, or I can have number of slope sign changes, or I can have what is the standard deviation. So those features are used to train, to extract the information from a different exercises. Like for the bicep curl, there will be a different set of values for those feature. For the different exercise, for example, bicep hammer, there will be a different set of values for the same features. So this will see at the end. We'll have Google Collab for implementing the same, where I'll explain what are the different features we can use to distinguish between the different exercises. So another sensor which is used is a PPG sensor, which is very common in your for the heart rate. There's a LED and a photodiode. So in presence of whenever there is a less reflected light, so depending on your cells, so there's a change in absorption, and with the help of Beard-Lambert's law, you basically identify the different heart activities. So how it actually works is we do certain kind of pre-processing where we from your raw data we convert it into the usable data where it may be the calibration or not calibration, maybe from raw data we can actually derive the heart rate signal, and from that heart rate signal you might have a certain kind of motion artifact, like we are doing a walking or jogging along with your sensor, so there is a movement, so there is not a continuous you're not in continuous contact with your skin. So there may be because of that as well as because of the motion, so there's a certain kind of artifact introduced in your signal. So we have to remove those motion artifacts. Then once your the motion compensated heart rate signal is derived, we then do a peak detection. And once we do the peak detection, at the end you will get a heart rate calculation. There's a really good paper demonstrating the same. So I have provided the link for the same so that you can go into the detail if you want. So this is how the heart rate measurement algorithm normally works, where you start from the pre-processing to the motion artifact removal, and then for the you can do the peak detection. Similarly, from the PPG sensor, there are two possibilities. Like if you are just interested in the heart rate measurement, if you have only one LED and one photodiode, that is good enough. But in case you want to do SpO2 measurement, you need two LEDs with the specific wavelength of 660 nanometer and 940 nanometer, and a one photodiode. So as the absorption of light at different wavelength is different. So as oxygen hemoglobin absorbs more light in infrared, while in the deoxygen hemoglobin allows more infrared light to pass and absorb the more red light. Once we get the absorption of the red light versus the infrared light, we can derive in the ratio, which will finally give you the percentage of oxygen saturation. Similarly, from the PPG sensor itself, you can have blood pressure measurement. Those blood pressure measurement from the PPG sensors are, even if in the current devices, are not that accurate time being, because PPG sensor won't give you direct blood pressure values. Instead, what we'll have, it can only give you an approximation of change in the blood pressure. So what the devices such as Samsung Watch 3, which having a blood pressure measurement feature, what they do is they ask you to provide your standard blood pressure value using our standard blood pressure monitoring, the cuff-based devices. So we have to provide them the reference values of your systolic and diastolic blood pressure. And whenever, as you have provided them the reference, as PPG can give you an approximation about the change in the blood pressure value. So it will reflect those changes in the references provided by you. So this is how the PP measurement with PPG works, but those are not that accurate time being in most of the wearable devices. But still, there's a lots of research going on into improving the accuracy of the cuffless blood pressure measurement. So ECG sensor, you must have known the Apple Watch have introduced ECG sensor into their devices. So this ECG sensor works a little bit different than the previously existed or the standard ECG data we extract into the clinic, where we have a 12-lead ECG and we gather ECG waveform from all those different leads. Here we have two set of sensors. One is on the back and one on the crown. So when we put a finger on the crown, we are actually completing the circuit from a one finger to the our heart and back to the wrist. So this way the watch can measure our heart's electrical pulses, and we can get the report over the phone. So this is the how Apple Watch will provide you the ECG detail over the phone. So you all must be familiar about it, like how the ECG signal is generated. So balances the electric signal with heartbeat in combination with the impulse waveform produced by the different specialized cardiac tissues found in the heart. It is possible to detect some of its abnormalities, like detection of various arrhythmias, like tachycardia or a bradycardia. So this is how the PQRST, the waveform, or you can say ECG rhythm, has been generated. So as you know, that heart is made up of four chambers, like atria and ventricles. The atria pump blood into the ventricles, and ventricle pump blood through the body. And with the each heart cell is with the polarization and depolarizations of the cells, and the action potential happens within the PQRST waveform is generated. So this is how standard PQRST waveform looks like. The P wave corresponds to the depolarization atria, and the pause between the P and Q wave is caused by the AV node delaying the electrical impulses and impulse to the ventricles. And the ventricles contract, we'll see the QRS complex. So again, later on, we'll see how we can do a QRS detection with the help of Pan Tompkins algorithm, which is the very old algorithm still used for the real-time QRS complex detection. So again, the atria repolarizes around the same time and the ventricle finishes contracted. So the activity is recorded and the various points into your ECG signals are logged. So there are, from the ECG data, we can have a QRS complex detection algorithm, that is a Pan-Tomkins algorithm, which is used, from which we can have heart rate and heart rate variability information. And again, from the ECG data, we can have the arrhythmia detection. So this arrhythmia detection from the ECG data is something similar to that of exercise identification, where we have a data, a time series data, where we apply a certain window. And in that window, we extract features from a time and frequency and a wavelet domain. And we use those features are being used to train the machine learning algorithm, which will differentiate between different kind of arrhythmias. This is now look, this is how ECG waveform is recorded into the Apple Watch. And let's see how we can use Pan-Tomkins algorithm to extract the QRX, to extract the QRX complex out of it. So Pan-Tomkins algorithm is actually developed in 1980s by the two researchers, namely Pan and Tomkins. So from those names, the algorithm name is given. Here we have certain steps involved. First step is a bandpass filter, where we apply the bandpass filter in the range of 5 to 15 hertz. And that is followed by the one sample difference, which is analogous to the derivative operation, which will preserve the steep slopes on the QRS complex and attenuates the shallow ones elsewhere in the waveform. After that, we'll do the element-wise square, which actually nonlinearly amplifies the larger portion of our signal and makes everything positive. So after that, as we apply the square, there may be a possibility of nonlinearity. And to remove those nonlinearity, we apply a moving sum or a moving average to smoothen out the signal. So after that, once your signal is smoothen out, we apply a peak detection algorithm, providing the certain threshold to get the R peaks. So as from the RR, those R peaks, we can have the RR interval can be calculated, and the corresponding the QRX complex is identified. In case of arrhythmia detection, I already said, like, we do pre-processing, and that we do feature extraction. When features are extracted, we do training with different machine learning models. And once your model is trained, we can test it with, again, the very raw data, where we'll again repeat the same process. From the raw data, we'll do feature extraction, and those feature extracted features will provide it to the model for the prediction. So there are different machine learning models are used, right, from naive-based to logistic regression, support vector machine, decision trees, and ensemble learning models like boosted trees, XGBoost, and random forest. So there are some other ensemble learning models where you can use SVM and boosted trees in collaboration. And on the basis of voting, you take a call. Like this, from the same data, you generate an SVM model. And again, you have a boosted trees model, or again, you may have a random forest model, and you take a vote, like, which model predicts which class. So depending on majority voting, the final class prediction is decided. So in case of ensemble learning with the boosted trees and random forest, instead of different algorithms, the same algorithm, the decision trees, is used on the different subset of the data. Like, from the same data, we take certain subset and apply the decision trees over it, and we take a prediction from that, and again we repeat this process or a different subset. So this process actually known as a bagging. So where in a random forest, we have a multiple decision trees, where we take a certain set of data Let's say I have a 10 samples. Out of 10 samples, I have taken two samples at a time, and I have trained my model. Then again, those two samples I will put back into my data, and again I will randomly select two more samples. So I can decide from my total samples how many samples I can take at a time, and depending on that, how many number of trees I need to consider before taking in a final vote. So that part comes into the hyperparameter tuning, that is model parameter optimization, where you have to select appropriate number of subsamples and appropriate number of trees to get best possible result. This is a simulation of how the different samples are taken. There is another method, that is boosting. So what we do in boosting is we take n number of samples from your data set when we apply a model, and we check those samples only for which your prediction is false. So this sample for which your prediction is false are known as a weak learners, and those weak learners are then again put it into your data, and from and that mixed with the other samples, and we use those weak learner along with the other sample to train in a model, and again we test the model performance, and again those samples for which your model performance is not good, or your prediction has a false prediction, are used for the in the next model. So we repeat this process till we'll get good enough results. So this is how the boosting algorithm works. So we can have some samples, from a training set, we can have some random samples. We'll train a model, we'll take those samples which have a wrong prediction, we'll mix it into your training set, and we'll again randomly pick the samples for the model training. Then again, those weak predictions are putting into the your set. We repeat this process till the number of weak predictions are very low or insignificant. So this is how the boosting algorithm works. Then we do model evaluation. So in model evaluation, there are the different parameters. So right from the false positive, from the true positive, to the sensitivity and recall and accuracy and F1 score. These are different evaluation matrices used. And confusion matrix has been plotted, which is again to your predictor class versus your true class. So where confusion matrix will give you get an idea about which particular class is getting misidentified with different class from your possible classifications. So plotting and confusion matrix will give you about how model is working. We'll look now how the exercise identification from the accelerometer and the gyroscope data. Where we do some for that, we first do start with the data collection, then data preprocessing. We extract some features, then we'll go to the model training, and to the and then followed by a model evaluation. So data is collected from the SmartBand. This data actually was collected in my previous company. Activate variables, we are on our own SmartBand. We have collected data with different exercises. Here for the reference, I have considered only the few set of exercises, namely bicep curl, hammer, front raise, lateral raise, military press, bicep concentration, and single tricep extension. You can add many more exercises into it collect the data with the help of accelerometer and gyroscope sensor, and can do the exercise classification. We need to do some kind of reprocessing, as it depends. In our case, the sensor was MPU6050, where you have accelerometer and gyroscope data. And for the accelerometer, it was for the 4G to the minus 4G scale. But from the IMU sensor, what the raw data you get, that doesn't represent your acceleration. So to derive an acceleration from your raw data, what we do with the raw acceleration values, as your raw acceleration data gives you the values from zero to the 65, 536 values, and the expected acceleration values is -4 to 4G. So to make it into the both negative as well as positive values, we subtract 32768 from your raw data, and then divide by 32768 again, and multiply by 4, because in our sensor you have a different settings, so that you can configure your IMU sensor, as our IMU sensor was configured for the 4G, plus 4G and minus 4G, which is good enough to track and exercise data. When you are going with a very intense activities, maybe like while doing in the bowling or something, so the bowling action data recording, you might have to use plus 8G to minus 8G data. Otherwise, for the plus 4G, minus 4G, your data will be in a saturated form. So once your data, we got the data here. This is an example how from the accelerated data, we apply a window with a certain overlap. Here overlap take window size is 80, as 80 samples are taken at a time, and overlap is 20, so that you are not missing any continuous part from the previous window. So in order to do that, we applied these parameters are actually tuned after doing many experiments, and we identified this is like window size 80 and overlap 20 works for the most of the exercises. Model training with the boosted trees, then XGBoost and a random forest has been done. So let's see example of we'll go through the Google Colab notebook, and we'll see what are the features we have extracted, how we train the model, and what is the performance of the model. So let me just change from my presentation to my browser. Give me a minute.
Sir, in the meantime, can I say one thing to you? Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, yes, sir.
Sir, actually, if you say something about that data acquisition or in transmission to the cloud, that means real-time visualization. So I will discuss after when it will be finished, because I am searching for a few 1.5 years, and okay. Another FTP I have attended. And there, one madam, that madam told that use a platform specifically, but that platform is also not working to transfer the data in cloud in high frequency rate.
Okay,
that we want to visualize the. Actually, I want to visualize the signal. That means real time visualization, but from the cloud platform, not like that.
Okay, not on mobile devices. What we did in our case is as our band. The processor we have used in our band wasn't good enough to process and do feature extraction and everything on the band itself. So what we do is we sync our band with our mobile device having Android and iOS platform via Bluetooth. So over the Bluetooth, the data of accelerometer and gyroscope was transferred onto the mobile device. And on the mobile devices, we developed an app where our app itself was able to do exercise identification. So there are another possibility is, but again here the processor, the mobile processor, is not that computationally efficient compared to the computational power we can get into the cloud. So there are many limitations into the doing computations on a mobile, that many complex things you cannot execute on the mobile devices. But in last few years or so, the computational power of the mobile devices increased immensely. So nowadays, many, like right from the Google for their Android devices and Apple for their iOS devices, provide you some standard platform to do the data processing over the phone itself. So for the standard approach of doing it or developing an algorithm or code over the phone is, we write down a code into the C++. So what that gives an advantage is that once you get in raw data, and from that either on an Android device or iOS devices, you can use.
Sir, I want to know that suppose I am taking the ECG data, and one doctor from USA, he or she want to see that live ECG through that cloud. So I want to that how that using that cloud platform, that data will be transmission for real-time visualization. That when ECG or maybe PCG, any that signal that can be visualized.
You're speaking about specific to variable, IoT, existing variables?
Okay.
So there are two possibilities. Either your variable devices have data connectivity within it, like the existing devices such as Galaxy Watch or Apple Watch doesn't need phone to communicate with the internet. So what we can do is those raw data can be directly transferred to the cloud platform. But here, at this moment, I'm not sure there will be exact real time. There will be some visible delay in it. So what is the process is you capture a raw data, and as you are continuously capturing, let's say you are capturing 20 samples per second. So from 20 samples per second, you're capturing, and with every 20 samples, you are transferring that 20 samples over the cloud. But those 20 samples are actually not good enough to represent your signal. Like
for your CPU,
you might need a more number of samples.
Minimum 512 or 156 or 512. 256 or 512.
So what my point is that you can do, it not require that after getting 500 samples, you to do synchronization with the cloud. What we can do is you can have a lesser number of samples, it totally depends on your sampling rate. So if your sampling rate is, in case of ECG to follow the Nyquist criteria, you might need more than 500 samples per second, like because the ECG signal varies around 0.1 hertz to 120 hertz. So in that case, you're getting 500 samples at a time, but those 500 samples doesn't represent your entire ECG waveform. So to represent entire ECG waveform, you need many more samples. So what you can do is with as your sampling rate, let's say the 500 samples per second, you take those 500 samples per second and transmit over the cloud. Normally you can do it is those data sample values are in form of array, and those arrays will be saved, can be saved in terms of a CSV file, and that CSV file can be uploaded into the cloud. Some in Amazon Web Services, what you can do is you can upload those CSV file into the storage service, their S3, and
Amazon Web platform, sir. I know. Okay, that means in that form I have to upload.
Okay. So
hello.
Yeah, so I'm not sure right now like how you can do exactly in real time, but with some tweaks, like not sending larger data at a time but small chunk of data in a very continuous manner, you might able to do not exactly a real time, but maybe a delayed one.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And I'm sorry for interrupting in between.
Yeah, it's okay. No issues. So even after the presentation, also if you want to discuss this with me, feel free to do so. So okay. We can discuss this later.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Let's see how we can have.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Can you see my? Can you see my screen? Hello.
No, sir. It's not
visible. No, sir.
Now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, let's start with this. So we have imported some libraries. This is a training data set I have in the Excel file. That training data set is around 18,829 raw values. And out of raw values here, can plot it. This is a conversion I did from the raw value to get an acceleration, angular velocity values. So here we can see different exercises. This is the accelerometer values for the bicep curl, gyroscope. For the hammer, this is different. Like from these plots, you can see the pattern for the bicep curl for the AX is different for the pattern for the hammer curl exercise. So these are the different variation in pattern is observed over the different exercises. Similarly, for the lateral raise, it is different. And that variation you can observe on all three axes. Sometimes it happens that variation is observed on one specific axis, but constant on other. So that's why we consider all three axes for the pattern recognition purpose. So these are the different patterns for the different exercises over the accelerometer and a gyroscope data. These are raw values. You can see. These are the class labels I have given. So I have given different class labels, like for the resting, it is 1, for the bicep curl, it is 2, for the hammer, 3, front raise, 4, for the lateral is 5, for the military press, 6, and for the bicep concentration, it is 7, and for the single tricep extension, it is 8. So now start with the very important part of it, that is feature extraction. So from the raw data, we have to derive certain features which can do or can differentiate between the different patterns of the different exercises. So here, let me run through it. These are the various features I have used, where there's a discrete value transform approximation and a detailed coefficients. And similarly, the mean, RMS, standard deviation, covariance, then maxima, minima, number of zero crossing, then correlation, the max mean between the max mean difference between AX, AY, AZ, then signal magnitude area. These are the various features. These features are actually derived by doing lots of experiments. We have tried different features, and at the end we find out that these features are actually good enough to differentiate between the different patterns. Later on, we can test and check out how these features are able to do do prediction for the different exercises. So this is one of the important features, which is from the wavelet domain. So which actually was really good, which immensely improved the accuracy of the model. So which is DB3, which is from Dobbiecz's family. This is the mother wavelet we have considered here. We have tried with the different one from a simlet and all. Normally we take a mother wavelet which actually resembles with your variation in your data, like the normally your pattern of your data set, similarity with the pattern of your data set, if it resembles, on basis of that we select the mother wavelet. And here we do discrete wavelet transform, and we taken the approximation and coefficient parameters. So again, different like signal magnitude area, where the sum of the absolute values of x and ax, ay, z has been considered. Simple features like the maximum value, maximum peak. In case in a window you have a multiple peak, then it can identify the maximum peak and can give you the value of it. These are the different features. So these features are extracted like this manner. You select certain window, and I take one frame at a time. So my one frame comprises of the 80 samples, and this frame with the overlap of 20. For example, my first frame is for sample number 1 to 80. My next will be from 21 to 100. So from the sample number 1 to 80, we derive certain features. And from the 21 to 100, we derive different set of features. So we are not taking one raw data time. Instead, we are taking a window. And from window, we are extracting certain features. So over the entire data, this process is repeated. Here we can. So let's calculate the.
Yeah, इधर कोई ना पढ़ दे.
Let's calculate the features.
मस्त सीरीज है ये.
चांदा पिक्चर में कब मेरी पत्नी आती पिक्चर जीवन
दिया. क्या महीने सीरीज.
Feature calculation will take some time. Meanwhile, I already executed this previously, so you will get an idea. Like, there are total 83 features or 83 columns, and the I get total records are 9954. So 83 different features with the 9954 records has been taken for the training. Here I have just calculated features for one specific exercise only to test it later on. Then the extracted feature this is done with the feature extraction. Then these extracted features are divided into a training and the testing data. So that training and testing data, we have imported some of the classifiers, like from the sklearn.ensemble, the gradient boosting, random forest. Then we do train test split. So splitting data. So here we have taken test size as a 0.33, so that 33% will go to the testing and 67% of data will go into the training. So those available 67% of the data we applied gradient boosting classifier, and this classifier we used for the prediction purpose on your test data. So once this predicted variable will get the predicted label for the test data, and we'll compare it with the actual one, that is the y-test is the actual labels, and which is so we draw the confusion matrix with the predicted one with the y test. Here you can see some of the exercises has a confusion. So actual exercise is there are two set of examples where the one that is resting is being misidentified with the military press. So this is how, again, these are the misidentification. Again, you're sorry, not resting. Zero will be our resting here, and one will be the bicep curl. So our bicep curl is actually getting misidentified with the bicep concentration, which are actually two similar exercises. So bicep curl we normally do in a standing position, and the bicep concentration we do in a sitting position. So these are actually the two similar set of exercises, and we can observe there is a confusion between those exercises. So similarly, we can try with the different exercise, a different model, that is XGBoost classifier. You can train it. And see confusion plot. So there are two examples where bicep curl is again misidentified with the, here scenario is different. Actually there was bicep concentrations, and but algorithm identified as a bicep curl. So again, very similar set of exercises, there is a confusion. As set of exercises similar, the pattern for those exercises will have very minor variations. Now we can try with the accuracy was with this model was around 99%, and again we have just considered only very few set of exercises. When you add many more exercises in your data set, your accuracy will start getting affected. So here we can, for this we actually get almost 100%. There's no confusion cases at all. So this is the approach how you do apply windowing with a certain overlap, and use certain set of apply certain set of feature. You need to do feature engineering for that. You need to have knowledge about the domain or your data set, and depending on that you decide which features will work best for your application, and with the help of those features derived through extensive research, you can actually apply to the machine learning algorithm to have really good prediction. Similarly, we'll look to the QRX complex detection, which is actually implementation of the PanTomkins. The libraries. This is how I'm mounting my Google Drive with the Google Colab, so that you can, whatever data wherever you have on your Google Drive can be used into the Colab notebook. So this is the how PanTomkins algorithm is applied or the signal. So we pass sampling frequency information into the bandpass filter. Where here sampling frequency was around 300, and on those sampling frequency we do we apply a differentiation operation, and on the differentiation we do the square, and on that square we do the moving sum. So this is the same what we have seen into the previous presentation. How and let's see how this is working. This is the ECG data. This is how pre-process signal looks like after applying the moving sum. So your distinct pick over this. We can detect our pick. So this is how the QRX, the R interval can be derived from the ECG data. So this is the implementation of the PanTomkins algorithm. I will provide both of these notebooks to you so that you can go through it and try it yourself with the different combinations of the model parameters, as well as you can try out your own set of data. As so one of the previously is working on the ECG data. So instead of exercise data, you can try out ECG data set along with the different classification of different arrhythmias, and let's check out whether features used in case of exercise identification can be used for the arrhythmia detection or not. May not be all, but some features might be useful to you, so you can take advantage of it. I think with this, I would like to conclude my session. and we'll provide those sample notebooks to you so that you guys can try out by yourself. So thank you, everyone. Hello, Utkarsh. Hello.
Hello.
Your screen is not visible.
Share has completed. Sir, hello.
Yes, yes, sir.
Sir, actually, sir, Patel sir is Kalpesh Patel sir is not here. Then I can ask a question.
Just now he sent.
He has left.
Yes, he has left because of some reason, urgent meeting.
Okay, sir. Actually, I need his contact because I am last 1.5 years. I'll contact with you because I want to discuss with him regarding on that issue what I have discussed, and I think that he can solve because I am trying 1.5 years, but this is a really challenging job and I am not getting any solution.
Sure, sure, sir. I will share contact with you. You just send a text message to me on the WhatsApp. I will give you the contact number details.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we are ending this session now. Okay, all participants, you can leave now because of the urgent meeting. He has left. So we will continue in the next session. You can all leave now. Thank you.